The last round of last round of
This is Ken, and you're watching The Last Round of Horror Show, right here on CTO TV. Yeah.
This is Grant here, and you're listening to The Last Round of Horror Show.
We're around the corner, you're watching The Last Round of Horror Show on CTO TV.
Last Roundup Horror Show. I'm Frank. We got Eric Miller here with us. Jason, of course, on the end there. How's it going?
It's going good.
It's been a while. We watched a slew of movies. A bunch of good ones this time, in my opinion, so you're not going to get a bunch of weird shit. But we're going to start things off with Redwood Massacre. 2014. Summary for this film. What begins as an exciting camping trip to the legendary Redwood murder site takes a terrifying turn when the innocent campers discover the legend is about to become a nasty and bloody reality. Written and directed by David Ryan Keefe. Do you have any additional details on this?
Tagline, "No one is safe." Distributed by Uncorked Entertainment. This has a German Blu-ray release, but only on DVD here in the U.S., and that was out in 2015.
Yeah, there are some really rough actors in this movie, and the one girl I can't identify because only one of these people has a photo on IMDb. Like I'm trying to figure out who's who. There's one person that has a picture.
Are you trying to find the eyebrow girl?
Yeah, with the distracting eyebrows, and she has like unnatural skin. I don't know what
those eyebrows are awful.
Yeah. There is a part of your face where, like, you can still see your other eyebrow. It's just weird. I'm probably being really petty here, but I don't like her at all. She's so distracting. She's like a freak show. Also, it's weird to me that she's the most intelligent camper amongst these people. She knows shit for some reason. I am a really big fan of this. There's a drunk guy that's in the movie for a really short amount of time. He yells at his wife, "I don't hear no cans being opened, bitch!" And then he listens as his wife gets killed while he's pissing. He of course, gets eliminated really quickly in an accident a bunch of times. So he's dead, but that was the highlight of this film for me, was that guy, probably. Some pretty disturbing and well-done gore happens throughout this movie. I think that the kill sequences are awesome. They're really well done. But the killer looks like he is like on tour with Slipknot or something.
He could be in a band.
He definitely looks like he's in the Mushroom Camp or one of those bands. But they're really well done kills. I tried as hard as I could to find the true story that this is based on, but I think that they just kind of threw that in there.
I didn't go that far.
I couldn't find it. I think they were just basing it on the fact that somebody killed some person at some time.
I do know when I was watching it, because just going off the name, I'm expecting to see a slasher that takes place in a redwood forest.
Yeah.
So they start off hiking. They got little skinny trees. I'm like, okay, this clearly is not going to be in a redwood forest. But I guess the house is nicknamed Redwood. The Redwood House.
The kills overall are hyper-violent and rather disturbing. There's a ton of blood in this film. There's a hacksaw scene that's really fucking raw, but then it's countered by a comical scene where the killer is evidently pickling the dude's brain. He's like got all these
like
jars.
Cannon.
He's like cannon, doing a little canning in the middle of the movie.
Oh, yeah, he even trims fat off. And
he's really doing a good job. tip for life, though, if you're ever in this situation, you have an axe. Never fucking don't put it down. They put the axe down.
Do.
If you are in that circumstance, go ahead and hang on to that. It's pretty safe to have that with you, no matter what. There's another problem I have aside from the Slipknot masks. The punching sound effects. Did you catch on?
On every little thing. I was telling him last night. Like it's almost like video game sound effects, and like that's got to be just like public domain sounds or something. You just grab real quick and put it on there.
Watching it the second time, I noticed it.
Yeah, it sounded like a video.
Especially
game.
When he throws that big knife into the tree.
Yeah.
It's the same shit going in as the shit coming out.
The dumbest thing in the world is that the father character has been mourning the loss of his daughter for 10 years and doesn't try to kill this murderer. Instead, he just lets him kill him really easily. This guy's been, like, tracking this dude down. He just basically lets the guy kill him. Just go ahead and do it. The movie would have been a really solid glass of water movie if they didn't have the kills. I think the kills are really what makes this movie. I gave it a 6 out of 10. The soundtrack sucks ass a little bit. It's a good modern slasher with some memorable kills.
I think it's just like free. Something that we could do, as far as, like, nothing was composed. There was no composer or anyone. So what we got here, it's a low-budget UK slasher. Again, I was expecting a slasher in a redwood forest, but we still got in the woods with camping, hiking, streams. There's a gorge. There's a gorge.
That's the basis of the true story. Someone went camping.
It is on a little bit on the generic side. Like, everything is basic. Nothing you haven't already seen before.
But everything you like, Jason.
But it does. It's filled with tropes. But again, I don't expect too much. Give me a slasher in the woods with camping and everything. And don't make it suck.
Right.
And I'm probably gonna like it. Like, I'm not looking for any crazy deep stories or any really new stuff. Just keep it simple and do it well.
It's like saying I like birthday cake. You just like birthday.
Yeah. The kills are the best part for me. They're brutal. They look really good. And at the end, I should have wrote it down. At the end of the movie, it said blood supplied by. Oh. So there was like a company that came in and did some stuff. And a lot of the kills are during the day. And I think that makes the effects part of it even better, because you're not able to light it just right to maybe hide something or make something look better. They also didn't have the budget to do that, but that was pretty impressive to make stuff look good during the day. Pacing is good. On top of it being an hour 22 minutes, I thought it was easy watch. I like the mask. I've seen Grim Stitch Factory. I've seen people. They might even post it in the group somewhere.
Right.
But I've seen the Facebook page. It's another scarecrow mask. Again, nothing new, but I thought it looked well. I may have got distracted or something, because I don't know how the story goes from the forest to the junkyard. I didn't get how we made it to the junkyard. She gets in the car with someone, but he's like, we're going in circles, meaning that they've come back to the house where the killer is. But I didn't see how we transferred to the junkyard, but that might have been my fault. No. I'm not sure how now that I've had time to kind of process it all, at first I didn't like that he took hostages.
Right.
Like, give me a slasher, kill him, move on to someone else. He takes him and tortures him. So it goes from, starts off a slasher, kind of goes to a little torture porn, and then we get back on the slasher part of the end.
But he's also doing the meat processing in the middle.
Well,
about a time
you
up somewhere.
Do it right.
At first I didn't like it. It was like, we're just kind of wanting to kill him. But then I was like, well, I gotta give him credit for doing something a little bit different.
The creative. You get points.
There's no story there, but you know what? It's not actually, it doesn't really follow the formula, because they don't normally capture him and torture him.
Right.
He does. The ending shit. The movie does just as much good stuff, I think, as it does bad stuff. So it's middle of the road. I think it's worth a watch. I give it a 5.
Wow. Yeah, I too like the mask. I'm a fan of the Grim Stitch on Facebook.
Yeah.
It's been for a while.
That's
I was
cool.
actually excited when I saw that mask appear. I was like,
I didn't know if their intentions, I mean, they probably didn't set out to make masks for movies, but it's cool that they got in a movie.
Yeah, really. There's three of them, and I can't remember the other two.
I say you support cool people doing cool things. I'd look them up.
The kills I thought were the best part also. Excessive blood, like I mentioned. A couple.
Yeah, whoever that company is. We should
couple punches to the face, and there's like a gallon that comes shooting out of their head. But I love the black chick when she gets stabbed in the gut. Holds her against the wall, but then he starts pulling her innards out with his hands.
About that. Awesome. About that. Awesome. This guy is a known cannibal, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why is he wasting all them good sweetbreads? That's the good stuff. You know, if you watch any cooking show, that's the shit that they always like, these sweetbreads, they're just,
Have you had sweetbreads?
Never would eat them.
Do you know what they are?
I know what they are. I've never eaten that.
I like the fact that there's several mentions of the other partygoers that you never see.
Yeah, it's supposed to be like a
big party.
It's on like the anniversary,
but
too.
But I do like, I like the fact you get to see what happened to them.
Huh?
You get to see them. They're the ones. They're the ones that are all tied up, hanging by their hands when she's pushing through. Most of them are dead. But there's a couple of girls that are still alive, and they're wanting help.
Still, there's like 10 people.
But I'd like that you got to see them.
Yeah.
It wasn't horrible acting, but I kind of disagree with the pacing. It almost went too fast.
In the very beginning?
Yeah, it was very dull. You didn't really get to know those people. It was just boom, and then...
I guess probably what left the mark on me is that it got going right away. Yeah. It didn't drag you on, and then the last 20 minutes go.
You are right about the geography of the movie, though. It doesn't make any sense. They didn't think about that at all. Like, wherever they were positioned, I can't in my brain think of...
Oh, I don't know. And I didn't mention it. The house is cool. Like, wherever they're at is cool. Like, you got all those barns. But again, it feels familiar. Like, I know I've seen that kind of layout.
Yeah.
Well, like sheep barns or whatever.
Right.
But still, it was cool setting. I like the house. I like woods, too.
In the ending, the guy, she gets in with the van. She falls asleep and then wakes up. And he's like, we drove around in circles. No, they showed him travel at least 10 miles on a main highway.
I don't know. They got to a junkyard. They got to a junkyard. I don't know.
You were on a blacktop road.
Yeah, he didn't end up being, like, he was telling the truth.
Yeah.
He didn't end up being a bad guy, right? He got killed, right?
Yeah, right, yeah.
So I don't know what he...
Yeah, he's like, I'll go back to the house. She's like, there's only one house
I'll just
here.
Walk.
Because
he,
first of all, didn't park close to a house. No. He was like, I'm just going to walk back to the house. Motherfucker, back it up. What are you doing?
Now we're even more lost. I'll walk. Leave you here.
You're old as shit. Why are you going to walk all that way?
And her knowing how to operate the crane drove me.
Did that pretty easy. I couldn't have done it.
Which how would you know? You would not know.
But I end up giving it a 6. This is one that I...
What'd you say wow for?
This is one...
You said wow to my 5 like that was ridiculous.
I'm surprised you went that high.
Oh, no. It's...
But no, this was my second watch.
It's middle of the road.
And the first time I mentioned to you last night, I was getting kind of aggravated at some people dumping on it, but a second watch, it wasn't quite as good as I thought it was the first time.
Oh, and what we were talking about last night with the budget, I did find out. It's 50,000 pounds, which is... equivalent to about 65,000 US. So 65,000 was the budget for this. That's not a lot. In the same ballpark with some other indie movies. We've talked to Justin Seaman. His ended up being 40, but that's because they had to reshoot a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, like the homeless
thing. And then that was a buttload of merchandise that was getting your Blu-rays out there. So, in the same ballpark.
Well, it's hard to make movies, guys. And expensive. Let's go into 2015 with Patchwork. The summary for this film, a bombastic throwback horror comedy that follows three young women who go out partying one night and find themselves Frankenstein together in one body. Now they must put aside their differences so they can find out who did this and exact revenge. Directed by Tyler McIntyre. And written by Tyler McIntyre and Chris Lee. They both worked on 2017's Tragedy Girls. Do you have any additional?
I couldn't find a tagline. It's distributed by the Orchard and released on DVD 2017.
I think that I saw the tagline was
Some Assembly Required.
It says it on the poster.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't know if that's a tagline or if it's just a sign on the fucking garbage can. Little trivia for this movie. little trivia for this movie. There's a reference to a basketball team called Pistol Shrimps. If anybody listens to Pistol Shrimps radio, there's probably nobody that does, but the one girl, that the roommate, wears the Pistol Shrimps basketball jersey. She's like, my roommate's crazy. That's a podcast that I listen to, and I gave points for that because it's a deep cut reference to something in my realm that no one else knows. But Maria Blasucci and Amanda Lund are both on that basketball team. So, it's amusing to see this shambles of a woman struggle to move around. I liked it a lot. It was amusing to me, like the same sort of thing from like that dude from Men in Black that's having a hard time, Vincent D'Onofrio. I really enjoyed that. I thought that the whole movie's idea was original, the way that they showed you the three women talking to each other and then the twist at the end. I thought the whole thing was original. I don't know if you guys have seen a movie that's like this.
Yeah, it's very, very similar to Frank and Hooker.
Okay.
I don't know if you've seen that.
A long time ago.
But
did they deal as much with multiple personalities?
Well, you didn't get them like separated like three.
Right.
It just felt a lot like that.
I love the score so much to where I looked up the composer. His name's Russ Howard III. He worked on Hobo with a Shotgun. That was his most notable thing, but he's done a million things. But it pointed me to find... He also did work on Gremlins Recall. Did you watch that? I put it in the group.
Huh. No, I was seeing it. I didn't get to it.
It's like a 10-minute long Gremlins short. I thought it was fun.
This guy did it?
The composer did music on it. And it popped up and I was like, what the fuck? I love that they made Maria Blasucci's character a psycho killer. And the fact that the two mild-mannered women are sharing a body with this crazy woman added a new wrinkle to the storyline. I really like the writing a lot on this. When this guy's having sex with this woman, though, you gotta assume that smelled real bad. That's so gross. Could you do that? I don't think I could do that.
You do what?
Go through with the sex with the Franken bitch. I couldn't do it. That had to be some stank on that hang down. I liked the ending a lot. I thought that the owl cat made me laugh because they show this owl cat at the beginning.
It's so bad.
It looks so shitty. And I'm like, what the fuck is that? And then they just disregard it. And then it comes back and they set up this whole joke that's him. He has a button. Release the owl cat. He hits it. The thing just flies off. It's just a cheap, lame joke that made me laugh. He also says, fly, Archimedes, fly. That's what made me, that's what got me. I think this would be a solid double feature with like Idle Hands or Deathgasm, something like that that's like fun. Maybe The Babysitter. It's a fun, gory comedy. I'll probably rewatch this a few times. 8 out of 10 for me.
So it's a Canadian horror comedy, but I don't think it does either well enough. There's a good amount of gore, but it never really feels like a horror. And I was expecting, I knew it was a horror comedy, so I was expecting there to be... I expect to laugh a few times. I never really did. Like kinda,
that big weird finger didn't get you a couple times, which like puts it in his mouth and she breaks it up.
I don't know. It didn't do much for me. The acting was okay, but I didn't care for the characters of the three girls when they're separate.
Yeah.
I didn't really like that. It felt weird to me. I like the monster, like they created her walking around, like it gave me more of that and less of them separate and normal. It's shot well, looks really good. I was very surprised on the production of it. It's well produced. It's entertaining, but I think this I'm using the glass of water on this. It's something to watch. I don't really recommend it, but I'm not going to say watch this movie, but I'm not going to say to avoid it. I have a 6 here, but I don't think it's supposed to be a 6. I think we're a 5 on this one. But I buy 5s, so if I'm out and about and I see this for a couple bucks, it's good enough for me to pick up for that. So I'm going with a 5.
Going with a 5.
I was worried starting off once they broke off into the three women and the gaggling and yapping.
Yeah, it was too much of a girl movie. I felt like I was watching a chick flick.
But you know, once they stayed away from that a little bit and leaned more on the creature itself, with the kills, once they started, it got better.
I kind of laughed. I'm going to interrupt you. I knew that.
See, I'm polite.
I did not. Well, I want to say I did. I think I did laugh a couple of times where the guy's on has the girl in the bed. He's like talking to her. I think I did laugh a couple of times at him. But
that finger was awful.
That's the thing. I kept asking, what body did that come off of? Because it wasn't any of those. Well, that was like a dude's finger.
Oh, it's bigger than any of ours.
It's like a very large.
It was almost
big
a toe.
Yeah, like, it's just big toe. All right, go ahead.
But I think there was plenty of kills, but I think more gore was what I was looking for.
I mean, it was a little like at the end scene, where the guts and stuff. But
the individual kills throughout.
She goes off in that frat house.
There wasn't enough.
It should have been blood. Yeah. Like she should have
looked like Redwood.
They should have got that company.
I thought the one dude and three chicks was kind of cool, other than the stench. It could have been nice for a guy, but...
she went down.
I don't know, I kind of lost my mind when I realized Madeline was in on it. I didn't see it coming.
Yeah, I didn't see it.
And then when you
either.
See the body parts in her fridge and all that, I'm like, this chick is...
Oh, yeah, it's...
psycho.
Well, the thing I thought was happening was I thought that was like a delusion. You know, sometimes it would be the zombie Frankenstein woman, but they would show like one of the women that was like taking over the body, like whenever she's laying down next
to. I think there is some issues there too. Yeah. I can't remember what it was, but I was like, wait a minute now. If she's doing this, and how's this person doing this? Because they're doing things all.
Like they're doing things. Individual things.
Yeah.
So what are the other ones doing, just hanging out?
Yeah, I don't know.
I ended up giving it a 6.
Yeah, it's I enjoyed it. But here's the next two we have here are real dynamites.
I think I probably would have made it a 7 had it not been for that owl.
You didn't do any one-star reviews?
No, did you?
No.
No, God, no.
You're the one-star review guy.
Oh, am I? I've become that? No, up next we got 1980s Maniac. Summary for this movie. A psychotic man, troubled by his childhood abuse, loose in New York City, kills young women and takes their scalps as his trophies. Will he find the perfect woman in a photographer and end his killing spree?
I don't know.
Stay tuned.
Directed by William Lustig, known for the Maniac cop films and 1996 4th of July themed film, Uncle Sam.
Oh, well, since we're on him, I just want to go ahead and say, William Lustig, he started in adult movies.
Oh, wow.
Then he ended up working at Anchor Bay, and now he's the guy that runs Blue Underground.
Right. There you go. Written by C.A. Rosenberg and Joe Spinell, who plays Frank Zito in this movie. Do you have additional details?
Tagline, run from the man. Distributed by Malice.
Is that it?
That's what I got. That's what's on IMDb.
Wow.
Distributed by Analysis Film Releasing Corporation. And this was just released. It's been on Blu-ray before. But the Blue Underground Lustig released a 3-disc edition in 2018. New 4K restoration. 7.1 sound. It looks and sounds great.
Now, did you watch the little kind of sequel?
I haven't watched that.
It's real short. It's like 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Evidently, Spinell was going around just telling people they had jobs. Like, you're going to be in my next movie. You're going to be in my movie. He was so upset by the backlash that this movie had because they had like booths set up outside of theaters for this. Where you go in, just pay a quarter or whatever, check out like scenes from the movie, like a smut type thing. And women went crazy and they started protesting and stuff. And he hated it because he fucking loves women. He's Italian ladies, man. And he said, I'm going to redeem myself. So he made this short about a child entertainer who's killing abusive parents or something like that.
So while we're talking about Spinell, he was in the Rocky movies, Godfather movies, Taxi Driver. So like this, from here, he went on to do some. Well, I mean, I don't want to like say that like, this movie ain't you know, no good or anything, but those are some big blockbuster movies.
Gene Siskel left the film before its conclusion because he said the shotgun scene left the film in a place where it could not redeem itself. I don't know what that means. I've seen far worse than that. But the hooker at the beginning uses a lot of prostitution terms I'd like to speculate on. She says a regular, a French style, around the world, and the ultimate.
Yeah, the ultimate. Now, $100 for the ultimate.
What do you suppose?
I was reaching for my wallet.
I can assume the regular is just like straight regular sex. French style is like head, right? With the mouth, right? You can assume. Around the world, I'm assuming, is around the backside, right?
I don't know. I don't know.
Back in the day, around the world meant everything.
Oh, everything.
So ultimate, I'm trying to figure out what you add to everything.
Yeah, that, it was confusing. I couldn't think of a fourth level at all. But another thing about the prostitute at the beginning, don't you think she's wearing unwieldy whore clothes? Because, like, she's got a whole fucking one-piece deal, and she's also got like pantyhose on. You would think you'd want like a skirt or something.
The look on your face is of disgust.
Well, it just didn't make sense. I think that Joe Spinell is a perfect killer.
That's how they make their money. It'll take an hour to get undressed.
They wear it.
Oh, hurry up!
He's like, no, leave him on.
I think the way they utilize the voiceover as a vehicle for his internal monologue gives it a real, like, Taxi Driver style feel. At the same time, I think they might have done it better here because at some points he's saying stuff to his mannequins or himself at the same time as the exposition goes by. So he's like talking to the little details make this movie like a gem. When he's loading his shotgun into the case, he's eating Cracker Jacks and it's like falling down and stuff. The little details, they help you put the puzzle together about who this guy is. Tom Savini's shotgun death is one of the most memorable scenes. I mean, that's the one thing I remembered about this movie. I haven't seen it in at least like 10 years or so. The soundtrack's great. It's got a lot of really fun flangey stuff. Where do you think that Frank gets all his mannequins? Those things seem to be like...
He must be, I don't know, dumpster diving or whatever. I mean, he stops at storefronts and really gives a look. Enjoys looking at the mannequins.
I just thought, even nowadays, it'd be hard to... They'd probably be highly expensive to buy them. Whatever. I'll go with it. The one thing I don't buy is that Frank is charming enough to get this photographer to hang out with him.
He does have it. Ron Jeremy looking motherfucker. He's able to pull it together for a little bit.
And it just seems together.
It seems normal.
He seems as normal as he can be, but still, right. Look at him.
He combed his hair and put a jacket on.
I mean, he's like a model.
He talks so smooth with that.
The glasses.
Girl.
How did he do that? Because
he's very smooth.
He's really twitchy otherwise. I really want to know who voiced the young Frank when he has his hallucination at the end, because the voice sounded like somebody that I remember, like a kid that did voiceovers all the time, but there was no credit for it. I looked for about 20 fucking minutes. I'm not sure what they want me to think happens at the end, but I'm assuming he's hallucinating wildly and stabbed himself in the stomach or something, but they had like the mannequins turn into the women. This is a wonderfully dark, nostalgic piece of horror. I think if you haven't watched this before, you have to watch it. It's required viewing. 9 out of 10.
It's a dirty, sleazy 80s New York slasher. Which New York back then, you automatically have atmosphere. You automatically have a certain tone to your movie. Great music, great score. Soundtrack comes with the 3-disc edition. The effects looks as good as expected with Tom Savini, and his head exploding. It's one of the best that I've seen. Mm-hmm. And then he goes a step further, which is a little bit ballsy. They play it in slow motion.
Right.
So you're slowed down, so anything that doesn't look real is really going to pop out to you. They still do it because it was good. Shot well. A couple of my favorite scenes, when he's on the bedroom, in the bedroom, on the bed, he's talking to one of the mannequins, and the camera's moving around the bed, and it eventually gets to his sight lines to where he's staring right at the camera. And as dirty and sleazy as he is, I don't know, when he looked at that camera, it looked like, you know, he's looking at me, I was like, oh. And then it keeps on moving around the bed.
You greasy ass. You know,
like, what are you looking at me for?
Just like in your seat, like,
looking behind me, see? the foggy cemetery scene where they're running through there. Yeah. Like, you give me fog in a cemetery, it's another just atmospheric setting. I liked it. Good pace, never feels slow. He knocks off a couple girls before the title card even comes up.
Right.
In the beginning, they're happening pretty quick. I think it slows down. He starts kind of playing some cat and mouse games, but it don't take him long. Like, he ends up killing them in 15 minutes or so. So I like the pace of it. I liked Frank.
Hey.
He's creepy.
That's what my parents named me.
He's sleazy.
they could totally could have.
He's crazy.
I was born in 82, so they could have fucking named me.
He does look like Ron Jeremy. Definitely has mommy issues, but she was a whore. Mm. He talks about it. There were so many men. So
she'd burn him with cigarettes.
Moral of the story is, women, don't be whores.
Burn your kid with cigarettes.
I like the idea of the mannequins becoming real to him. I like them coming alive. Him nailing on the scalps, putting their bloody clothes on them. I like that part. And his death kit. Like, in slasher films, you either carry around the same weapon the whole show or pick him up as you go, but you never really see, like, everything's nice and neat. He's putting in shells and shotguns.
But he's real sloppy about stuff, though.
I'm just talking about his kit.
Oh, okay.
He's
there's blood everywhere.
He does love his kit. One goof that always sticks out to me is the subway scene where she's supposed to be alone. Mm-hmm. And then one shot, they switch angles, and there's eight or ten people on the other side of the subway, like, just looking around. I don't know how they missed that, but this is one of the movies that will rotate as my favorite slasher. I give it a 10. Definitely a must-see if you've never seen it. Watch it.
So for me, I hadn't seen this back in the day. I watched it a couple months ago for the first time, and yesterday was actually my second. Much better the second time. I was not a big fan of it the first. I liked it mainly because slasher films that I watch break off throughout the film. You follow characters here, victims, and see what's going on. This movie stayed with him the entire time. You get to see how he lives, what he thinks, why he thinks. I it was almost like a documentary style kind of feel to it. I like that. The shotgun scene obviously was awesome as hell. Excluding the people that appear and disappear in the subway, I like that.
The subway,
that
yeah,
scene.
It's a good setting.
I mean,
another
the way
good
they
setting.
Set it up, I mean, you could feel
the location,
the fear and the dread when that train pulled away and left her there all her own.
I would never fucking use that, ever. If I lived in the city, I'd be like, yeah, guess I'm fucking sleeping here tonight, guys, because goddamn that thing.
The ending scene where all the mannequins come to life, his head being pulled off.
That was wrong.
Almost as good as the shotgun scene, but
yeah,
I think it's second.
Savini did a good job with this.
Yep. I think my only complaint was it just takes off. I didn't see much of a script or plot to it. He just goes about it. I mean, you find out why he's doing it, but it took off. I mean, right from the get-go, that was the only knock I had, and I gave it a 9.
Well, that's an approved.
Would have been probably a 7 on my first viewing.
Yeah, the first time I watched this, I didn't like it as much as I did this time. I mean, I don't know what it is. It took me a lot to get through it the first time, but I think I've watched it in not a very good format. It was like not the clearest copy of whatever it was, you know, because this is an old as fuck film.
Yep.
So for them to restore it really does a lot for it.
Yeah, it looks beautiful.
I wouldn't know. Great. I saw it on DVD and looked like a VHS transfer.
Oh, that DVD didn't look
yeah,
good?
Yeah, it was not good.
Well, let's travel to 1992 for Dead Alive. I've always considered this one of my favorite movies, so the review is going to be glowing. The summary for this film: a young man's mother is bitten by the infamous rat monkey. She gets sick and dies, at which time she comes back to life, killing and eating dogs, nurses, friends, and neighbors. Directed by Peter Jackson, written by Peter Jackson, Stephen Sinclair, and Fran Walsh. They've all worked together on other things: Meet the Feebles, The Two Towers. The beginning. Oh, well, what do you have?
Tagline: Gone with the Blood. Distributed by Trimark. This was out on Blu-ray through Lionsgate in 2011. It's out of print. People want stupid money in it for now. 75 on up. Mm. But Peter Jackson has announced that there's going to... Meet the Feebles, this, and Bad Taste?
Bad Taste, yeah.
I don't know if that's coming out as a collection. I think it is, but if not... Anyway, that's coming out on Blu-ray. He's going to go through it. He's going to restore everything, so I cannot wait for that. That's going to be an automatic purchase for me.
Oh, yeah, for sure. the beginning segment of this movie lets you know what's going to happen. Like, I mean, it sets the pace right off the bat. And I believe it is Peter Jackson at the beginning, right? Isn't that him that's carrying the cage?
I don't know. I mean, I'm saying he sneaks in his movies, but
yeah,
I don't know.
I know he 100% is the autopsy guy's assistant. Or not autopsy, coroner. What the hell is that guy? Fucking Undertaker? What is he? Anyways, he's in this movie. He makes a couple appearances. When I watch these old Peter Jackson movies, I always check his IMDb to see if he's in preparation to return to horror. I'm like, waiting for him. Come on back, buddy. But he's evidently just dealing with some dumbass Beatles movie.
Well, I think he has made a comment.
Yeah.
He's going to return. He's going to do it.
Yeah, he's got a couple things on there right now, and it's not looking horror-y. What the fuck is to 10-10? He's making a 10-10 movie. Is that a thing that people like?
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's, I think it's a young boy. It's like a like detective Indiana Jones work. Yeah, something like that.
I love anything that's set in New Zealand. I don't know why, but it seems like there's a very specific sense of humor in any New Zealand comedy, whether it's this or Flight of the Conchords. Stuff from the region has just got the same sort of humor. The stop-motion rat monkey looks terrible until it gets its head smashed, and I really like that. I always like stop-motion, even though it looks terrible, so it works for me. I'd like to see a modern take on this movie with like a Tim Roth and a Salma Hayek in the roles of the lovers. That would work out well. The custard scene is nasty wonderful. I think it's the grossest scene in the movie.
It is. Too much. And I have that written down. It absolutely is.
This is the kind of situation that develops when you try to hide shit. Here's what you do, man. The minute your mom turns into a fucking undead monster and kills her nurse, who also turns into an undead monster, you fucking tell your girlfriend, all right? Just tell her, because you need an ally. You need somebody. You tell them. Tell them about it. Otherwise, you're not going to have anybody to help you, and it's going to be really hard to prove things. But anyways, Peter Jackson, yeah, like I said, plays a couple characters in this movie. It never seems forced when he's in one of his... He's always an asset. I'm glad to see him. It's not like Quentin Tarantino when he shows up and you're like, oh, fuck. Dude, come on. I only 15 minutes of you. The cemetery sequence is, of course, my favorite portion of the film for so many reasons. I want a movie of that guy, like a prequel. It would have to be a prequel because he dies. Of the priest just killing zombies and shit. That would be so good. There are so many iconic scenes in this movie. It would be really long-winded to go through all of them, but the zombie dinner scene is great. Of course, the cemetery scene. The scene with the baby in the park is fucking awesome. The ending, come on, dynamite all the way through. Everything about this movie hits the right tone. Small details like the uncle struggling to piss because of his urinary tract infection. The way the nurse's throat is slit and hinges at the back of her neck. Or when the greaser shoves a spoon through his entire head and it comes out the back. it's just the perfect shade of cheese for me. I didn't really need to rewatch this, but I did it anyways. And I'm going to give it a 10. Like I said, it's one of my favorites.
That UTI thing. Unless, go back, unless I'm mistaken. He's got kidney stones. Because when he first starts grunting, you hear it tink. And yeah, rattle around inside the pisser. I'm like, oh my god. Shoots out.
Yeah, so we got a very bloody movie. Arguably one of the bloodiest or the bloodiest. And it's disgusting. Again, but it's not so much for the gore. There's a couple scenes in here that involve pus. I can't do pus. Yeah. I could do blood and guts.
Wound is pus.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that's why it goes, and then the custard. Yeah. That's bad.
Yeah.
I hated the mom from the get-go. Peter Jackson, I don't know her name. But they did a very well job. Very well job. They did a good job. Like creating that, but just one. I wanted her to die right from the get go, especially when she like the WLW, whatever she said. I can't. And then she becomes even more disgusting. I hate her even more. The custard scene again is stomach turning. Special effects top shelf, and that's what this movie's all about. And they still hold up today. Like everything still looks really good. It's extremely over the top, very entertaining, fun watch. A couple of my favorite parts: the guy that gets the flesh ripped off his legs. Oh, yeah. It's just bones.
Oh yeah,
like that looks great. Being punched through the back of the skull again, that looks good. I'm not sure you can get it better today, but I think probably by. It's not a main part of the movie, but one of my favorite parts is the zombie that gets stuck up on the light fixture.
Oh yeah,
and her head's glowing, and you just see her in the background of all different kinds of scenes. She's just hanging there. She got a light shooting out of her mouth. She's just like in the background for like 20 minutes of this movie. She eventually catches on fire, but this Timothy Baum, he did a really good job as Lionel. But I would really like to see this movie. With Paul Reubens playing Pee-wee.
Okay.
Pee-wee's character.
Oh, wow.
With all this stuff going on. And then I started thinking about that and how great that would be. And so then my mind started thinking of other people. And I would love to see, is it Rowan Atkinson?
Yeah.
Who, Mr. Bean?
Yeah.
I would love Mr. Bean's character to be in the middle of all this. Those two characters, I think, would just make this movie unbelievable. Every time something
disgusting happens, he's like...
How great would that be? Or Pee-wee.
You're blowing my mind here, because I would never... You went into a whole different set of waters.
I did, too. I spiraled. It's one of the best horror movies. It's one of the best horror movies from the 90s. One of my favorite zombie movies. And I think it's one of the best examples of practical effects. I give it a 10.
Not much left for me to say. You've covered everything.
We're thorough.
I mean, personally, as far as the best horror film, probably not the best comedic horror film, yes. On that level, I would probably give it an 8. But the topics, everything you've touched on, is pretty much the same.
So you give it an 8 or you don't give it an 8?
8, yes. An 8. So I'm saying, it's not my favorite horror film. It's probably my favorite comedic horror film. Because there are a lot of funny parts, some silliness to it.
It's one of the best of me. It's one, again, like Frank, I did not need to watch this movie again.
The practical effects, though, yeah.
I probably watch this movie at least 2 or 3 times a year.
Yeah, it's one that I could write it on paper. What happens? I've seen it.
Nothing on TV. This is one that goes in. Return of the Living Dead's the same way.
Yeah,
it's definitely a good movie. I would recommend.
Well, that makes it approved, I'd say. We got
But we're never taking the guest into consideration.
Oh,
no. No, it'll be an average score, because episodes?
Last time you feel burned still? The burning?
The burning? I knew that was happening before it happened.
It's regardless of why the guest scores. If we average an 8,
right.
It's recommended.
Right. Well, we got some 5-word reviews here. Angela Molay had for Dead Alive, Your Mother Ate My Dog, which is actually what Dead Alive is called in Italy. That's what the DVD says.
Not the whole thing.
she says about Maniac, Greasy Mama's Boy Kills Women. It's pretty right on the money. James Ray says about Patchwork, at least there's some tits. He also mentions Maniac and says, box art dude was fit. He does have quite a package.
It's a very big bulge.
And Derek Dunson, just in general, review. Frank's pick, so immediate zero. Which, on this set of movies, there was no way he could have told which... I mean, granted, most of the time it's easy to tell which ones I pick. This set was not... It would have been hard, I think. So
I didn't know. I didn't know which one you guys picked. I just knew the two that I picked.
So that's that for this episode. We will see you next time. You can email us at lrhspod@gmail.com. And, yeah.
Oh, got a new sponsor.
Oh, yeah.
We're now sponsored by Skittles.
Skittles? Right.
They wrote me and told me.
That's cool.
Skittles. Taste the rain.